All right, I think we're going to get started here. I'm sure there's some people outside, but they'll start to trickle in. I want to welcome everybody here to the Lyme Disease in the Era of Precision Medicine conference. I know a lot of people made sacrifices to come here today, and it's a holiday for a lot of people, and the fact that we're at a Jewish hospital on a Jewish holiday, the irony is not lost on me for that, but scheduling, we have some of the best, absolute best people in the world in terms of Lyme disease research here in this room, and as you can imagine, they're all busy, important people, and getting them all in one spot was tricky, and we're just, I think, totally honored to have people coming from all parts of the country here to participate in this event. This is a new event here, so we look forward to your feedback and everything on how this goes. I want to start out with just a quick introduction here. I think many people in this room totally appreciate that Lyme's disease is too big to ignore, right? So I think, what is it being ignored? It's not being ignored by the patients, and of course there are clinicians that are working diligently to combat Lyme's disease, but you know, it does seem that in terms of national awareness and NIH funding, et cetera, right, it doesn't get the credit or the attention that it deserves. You know, looking at 300,000 new cases of Lyme diagnosed each year. If you want to put that in perspective from the terms of other diseases, right, that's actually, depending on how you count, 30, 40,000 more than the number of cases of new breast cancer diagnosis each year, right? So Lyme's disease far outweighs the breast cancer diagnosis even. And if you could contrast that with the attention that breast cancer gets, of course, breast cancer has a higher death rate, but as we'll discuss today, more and more we appreciate that Lyme's disease has significant consequences for all the patients that are affected by it that can last well throughout their life. And the precision medicine theme is a really important term that we're going to throw around here today as part of the title, because I think there's great opportunities to take these emerging precision medicine paradigms and apply them to Lyme's disease. And I appreciate that not many of you, you might have heard about the precision medicine initiative from the White House and have heard the term precision medicine, but don't really understand what that means. And you know, what it means is to really help us understand all of disease and even individual diseases with much greater precision using genomics, imaging, and all these great quantitative tools that are emerging in the life sciences. And one thing I always like to point out in my talks is that the allegory of Plato's cave is still really relevant in medicine today. And if you're not familiar with this allegory of Plato's cave, it's a thought experiment. I don't think they did this to people, but you never know back then. But these are prisoners here, you see. Chained in this prison, and the only thing they really know about the world is from the shadows that from these puppets that people bring by the fire, right? And that's their whole concept of the world is based on these projections of these shadows. They don't know what the real world looks like from the outside. And I would say the analogy, if you carry it forward in medicine, right, is we have a lot of symptoms and anatomy, some manifestations of symptoms, pathologies, and in a way, we've been looking at the shadows on the wall and trying to understand what's going on, you know, with disease. But of course, what underlies disease is an unbelievable complexity of molecular physiology, right? So if you just think about one cell inside the body, just a single cell, we have 3 billion nucleotides of DNA, right? And that express thousands and thousands of mRNAs, which form their own networks, start interacting with each other, start interacting back with the DNA. They make thousands of proteins. The proteins form their own networks, start interacting with each other, also go back and bind with the DNA. Metabolites, etc. So we're just talking about a single cell in the body has, you know, millions and millions of interactions. It's a whole universe, a constellation of interactions happening in just like one cell. Of course, cells form their own networks. Then physiology has its own layer of networks. The immune system, which of course is important to Lyme disease, is interacting with metabolism, is interacting with neurology. So we have this whole constellation of interactions underlying almost every single disease. Of course, the environment interacting with that from all sides. So it's no wonder that we've had a hard time trying to truly understand the molecular cause of many, many different diseases, given this unbelievable complexity. But you know, this is really changing, right? Because the power of genomics in particular is bringing the power of data to understanding disease. And what you're looking at here is a slide you'll see in a lot of genomics conferences, but if you haven't seen it before, it's the cost of sequencing over time, right? So the cost of sequencing a million or so bases of DNA. So back when the Human Genome Project first was announced, you're looking at, depending on how you do the accounting, let's say $1 billion to sequence a human. Of course, this line here is Moore's law, so this is the speed at which CPUs and storage technology will improve at this unbelievable rate we've been seeing computer technology improve. But what we see with DNA sequencing is that it's increasing at a super Moore's law rate, right? So now the human genome is roughly around the magic 1,000, but a huge order of magnitude decrease in just little over a decade. And as the technology improved, we have all kinds of new opportunities to understand disease. I added this little extra annotation on the bottom of this graph because I think it really hits home what this means. You know, so when technology was slow and expensive, we thought about sequencing organisms, you know, the chimp genome, the human genome. Then microarrays and other technology came out, and we got good at sequencing tissues. But today, we're unbelievably good. We take it for granted today, but it's astounding to me that about sequencing single cells, right? So we can do single cell sequencing, and pretty soon we'll be able to do single cell real-time continuous sequencing, for example, with the third gen Oxford Nanopore sequencers and things like this. So we can now measure and see biology in unbelievable resolution, and of course, genomics is just one of the amazing technologies that allows this. And this data is now accumulating in these public databases at an exponential rate. This is a gene expression omnibus database. It's a database that if you publish a genomic study, particularly a gene expression-based study, you have to deposit your data when you publish the paper. In the case of breast cancer, for example, there are now 50,000 samples that have where they've done genomic profiling that are available in this database that actually any high school student could download today. It's publicly available. Unfortunately, not many Lyme disease samples available, but that's something we're trying to fix here as part of this consortia. But if you think about it, that now that all this data is accumulating, a high schooler has access to more breast cancer samples than any single breast cancer investigator in the world, right? They just need the skills and abilities to work with this amount of data, right? So, and one thing we're reaching towards with all this information is something that was in the paradigm of precision medicine, I think is something that was articulated quite nicely by Eric Topol in this Cell paper back in 2014, is that we need to move away from these very rigid definitions of disease, right? So again, the taxonomy or the way we think about disease and how we study disease and the way it's organized in the hospital, you know, that was like a hospital we're sitting next to today, is, you know, a symptoms and anatomy-based taxonomy, right? This disease kind of does something to a heart, so it's a heart disease. This kind of does something to a skin, so this is a skin disease, right? And we have these very rigid billing codes, ICD-9 codes, diagnosis codes that we group disease by. But once we have lots of information, like molecular side all the way up to the environment, could we build a Google Maps of human disease, right? That's really driven by data rather than how we perceive symptoms and anatomy. And this is actually a paper from that when I was a graduate student back at Stanford, but it was a first look at this idea where we actually had lots of genomic data, a lot of molecular data on hundreds of different diseases, and we said, well, let's throw away all of our preconceived notions about how these diseases relate to one another, and let's just look at the genomic data, the shared pathways that are being perturbed, the shared genes that are being expressed, and let's just see how that organizes the disease taxonomy. And you'll see really bizarre things like Alzheimer's disease at a molecular level, which many of you know is a neurodegenerative disease, looks a lot like actinic keratosis at a molecular level. Sounds totally bizarre. Why would a skin disease look like a neurodegenerative disease? But as time has gone on, it turns out that, first you can think that the brain and the skin share a developmental pathway in the neuroectoderm. But there's a group in Mexico that published a paper 2 years ago, or a year and a half ago, where they've actually done a study where they can see tau tangles, which are a sign of Alzheimer's pathology, forming in the skin of Alzheimer's disease patients about the time of in higher incidence compared to controls, right? So as time has gone on and we have these tools to look at disease at a molecular level, this connection between Alzheimer's disease in this case and actinic keratosis looks less and less crazy, right? Because now we can look at these diseases through a molecular lens. So you'll notice if you're scanning that Lyme's disease is not up on this graph because at the time there was no Lyme's disease data in the public domain, looking at it at a gene, when this paper is published, at a gene expression based level. So again, one of the themes that I think will come up today a lot is we need more data, we need more public data on Lyme so we can do these more types of powerful studies. As another example, we had a study that was published last year where we did the same thing with our patient population at Mount Sinai. So we took all of the patients' medical record data, we took their labs, and we said, we're going to ignore whatever disease, you know, the physician said they have. We're just going to look at all the information we have on these patients And we're going to see how similar they are. Does this patient look like this patient, look like this patient, across, for example, hundreds of lab test values, height, weight, and these things. And when you look at the patients through a data-driven lens, instead of, you know, a sort of a preconceived lens about how these diseases should manifest, et cetera, in this particular case, you're looking at type 2 diabetics. And in this study, we found that there was actually three subtypes of type 2 diabetics that were sitting under our nose the whole time, but we just never noticed because we didn't look at our patients in a data-driven way. So again, this is a major concept behind precision medicine. If we have more information, molecular information, clinical information, can we start looking at today Lyme's disease in a very rich, data-driven way and really understand that maybe there are subtypes or more nuanced manifestations of this disease that we can start to investigate in new ways. And of course, precision medicine is a national priority. There's a precision medicine initiative being funded by the NIH with the green light from the White House. But you know, one thing to note about this is a lot of the talk on precision medicine has been focused on cancer for the most part, and a lot of the funding is going into cancer precision medicine. So I really think it's up to us in this group here to bring the enthusiasm, the tools, the technologies of precision medicine to Lyme disease. And that's what this conference is all about. And of course, an important thing, I'm sure there are patients, hopefully there are patients in the audience today, is that we have unbelievable changes in technology or emergence of new technologies like wearable devices. I've got two of them on today. Consumer health, Apple and Google getting to health in huge ways. Apple even developing things like Research Kit, which we work with Apple on, to allow mobile phone devices to launch huge clinical trials across the country, sort of more democratized access to clinical trials, allowing patients to participate and generate useful data and connect with physicians and researchers in a way they couldn't before, at a scale they couldn't before. So huge opportunities all around for precision medicine and Lyme disease. And I just want to end with this quote. I love putting this quote in my talks because it's so very true. This is the science fiction author William Gibson who said, "The future's here, it's just not very evenly distributed." And the take home from this quote for us today is that there are unbelievable technologies today. There are wearable sensors, genomics, immune profiling, metabolomics, proteomics, and you're going to hear about these all today. Powerful new technologies, and it's really up to us in this room today to figure out how we take these technologies and join forces and really distribute the promise, the power of precision medicine to patients with Lyme. So with that introduction, I would like to introduce Scott Friedman. So he's he has many titles here. I'm going to name a few that I remember. Dean of Therapeutic Discovery, Chief Division of Liver Disease, and he's going to give us a welcome here from Mount Sinai.
So thank you, Joel, and good morning. On behalf of Dean Dennis Charney and CEO and President Ken Davis, I want to welcome you to Mount Sinai. I saw that I was allotted 30 minutes. Even a dean probably can't speak for 30 minutes about his own institution. So I'll be much briefer, but I do want to frame Joel's efforts in this conference in the context of what's going on at Mount Sinai. I want to start by thanking the Stephen and Alex Cohn Foundation, who clearly been a great support and partner to Mount Sinai and to Joel's program in particular. Right now, you're at a very, very unique time in medicine. You know that, but you're also at a very unique institution. We're a relatively young medical school. We've been around for about 50 years, but the school grew out of a very old and venerable hospital. We are a single medical school now that is at the hub of a 7-hospital system that in aggregate accounts for 40% of all hospital discharges in the city of New York. So now we had merged several years, 3 years ago, with the Continuum Health System, so we're now 7 hospitals. This provides an enormous advantage to us in terms of population health, which is a major goal of our institution, but also in terms of acquiring data, phenotyping patients, all the kinds of things that Joel and his team have been doing. So I want to just highlight a couple of the, I think, unique features of this institution. First of all, we don't have an undergraduate tether. So we're not of this university. We are the beginning and end of our educational enterprise here. We obviously have a medical school. We have a graduate school, very robust graduate school. We now have nursing education at Beth Israel Hospital and so forth. But this gives us a lot of, I would say, nimbleness and flexibility to create programs to respond to the future, as Joel said, in a very nimble way. And the leadership here has done that very effectively. First of all, by making major investments in people of Joel's talents and skill sets. That includes an Institute for Personalized Medicine, in which we now have about 35,000 fully annotated patients that are IRB consented. We have available their DNA, in many cases their tissues. Those are being sequentially analyzed and sequenced. So obviously in the era of precision medicine, this is a really important resource. For those, many of you are involved in infectious disease, so I might add that now as a health system, we take care of more HIV patients than any health system in the United States. So we have massive scale. You know, I'm a liver scientist. I still make a living writing and getting rejected from NIH grants pretty regularly. So I know the feeling. But I have to say that Joel and his cohort have really transformed the way I view science. Those data sets that he was showing have really made me completely rethink disease organization within liver. And that's having a transformative effect on everybody at this institution. It reflects Joel's talent and those of his team, and now through his leadership in the Institute for Next Generation Healthcare, which itself is a very innovative and we think important initiative. But that works very closely with the Institute of Personalized Medicine, with major investments in Eric Schad and his team, of which Joel is a part, and the Genomics Institute and genetics. And all of this really has created a very fertile environment for us that is a really fun place to work. It's a place, because of our history, where clinicians and scientists literally work side by side. We define questions in a very, I would say, relevant way for scientists and for clinicians. We both learn a lot from each other, and for us this is really only the beginning. So it seems really appropriate that a program like this, focusing on big data approaches and precision medicine in Lyme disease, would be happening here. It reflects obviously an urgent unmet need, particularly in this region, but far beyond. It reflects the investments we've made as an institution to bring precision medicine back to the bedside. And there are clearly major challenges in terms of translating precision medicine information into actionable care at the front lines of treatment. But it also reflects, I would say, a unique time and place in terms of how genomics and big data are really transforming the way we think about science. And then I'll finally say that we're also, as an institution, highly innovative in terms of our partnering with foundations, as we are in this case, but also with pharma, with biotech. And I think I spent 16 years in the Bay Area at UCSF. Joel clearly spent quite a while there. He, in turn, has recruited a large group of people who share, I would say, the zeal and approach of getting things done, breaking barriers, changing rules, that I think truly has been part of the Bay Area for a long time. But I think you will find Mount Sinai as an island of that kind of culture here in New York. For reasons that completely escape me, New York has always been viewed as a little bit conservative and resistant to those kinds of changes. But that has clearly not been the case here at Mount Sinai because of our nimbleness, because of our investment in infrastructure around genomics and IPM, because of the kind of people we're recruiting, and because of our commitment to the future. I think we really stand ready to change the face of medicine for not just our community, but for the community at large. And so I want to thank you again for joining Joel and his team. Thank the Cohen Foundation. And I hope you have a fantastic conference. I think you don't need a liver doctor to talk to you about Lyme disease. So I intentionally kept my comments short so that you can spend more time hearing from keynote speakers and true experts in the field. So welcome again, and thank you.
We really want this to be interactive. We've got a format here that's maybe a bit different from the typical conference, where we're going to have some short talks from experts, and after this keynote here, we're going to have a couple sessions with short talks from experts, and then a lively discussion, hopefully. But we also want interaction, you know, from the audience and questions from the audience. We're going to keep you all well-fed and well-caffeinated as much as we can, so hopefully you don't have to, you know, sneak out to Starbucks or anything. And we hope that you really participate. And there's going to be regular breaks. We're going to have some refreshments after the conference, so stick around for that, and of course let us know if there's anything that we can do to make everybody here more comfortable. So we're going to get started, I guess, a little bit ahead of schedule, which is a good sign if we can, with the keynote from Kim Lewis. So I asked Kim how he wanted to be introduced, and he said to say my name and get off the stage. So it just kind of tells you what kind of guy he is, especially someone who might save us all from antibiotic resistance at some point. So Kim Lewis, a distinguished professor of biology at Northeastern University, and as I said, we may all someday, if you know his previous work, he might save us all from microbial resistance at some point, so we should all be grateful in advance. But of course, today he's going to talk to us about the great work he's doing in Lyme, so please welcome Kim.
Thank you, Joel, for the kind introduction and for the invitation. It's great to be here. My thanks are for the Cohen Foundation to organizing this and supporting a big effort in Lyme disease, which has been sorely needed. So what I'll tell you about today is about our work in a variety of infectious pathogens that is related to the general problem of treating infectious diseases, and of course about our data with Lyme disease. Okay, so for starters, I want to tell you that most chronic infections are caused by pathogens that are susceptible to antibiotics. And that is the main paradox of chronic infections. If it doesn't make any sense to you, that means that you are wide awake, because paradoxes make no sense. That's the definition. And what we found a number of years ago is that in, let's say, a typical chronic biofilm infection, the majority of cells are highly susceptible to killing by antibiotics, and then you hit upon this small subpopulation of persister cells, which are essentially invulnerable. So that, you know, that resolves the paradox. They are not resistant, they're not growing, and they're not dying in the presence of pathogens. So it turned out that these are dormant, spore-like cells. That explains their tolerance to antibiotics, which kill by corrupting energy-dependent functions. And so what we, here I'll give you a summary slide, a little over a decade of work from our lab. And what we found, first of all, is that the pathways of persister formation are highly redundant. And if there is a general theme in this case from the model organism E. coli, it is toxin, antitoxin modules of different sort that are persister genes and are responsible for persister formation. So these, for example, inhibit protein synthesis that causes dormancy. The interferase type toxins cleave mRNA that causes dormancy. And then this pathway, which was described by Toby Dorr, a grad student who's now at Cornell, although not in New York, right? On the graduate campus, he's a faculty there. So he found that the DNA damages, so S response actually turns on, apart from DNA repair, turns on this very interesting protein, TISB, which is an ion channel, decreases partially the protein morphophores in ATP, and that causes a whole system's shutdown and dormancy. And that's that will be especially relevant to what I want to say today, as you will see in a moment. Okay, so armed with that information, we decided to see what happens with persister formation in gram-positive bacteria. We took Staph aureus. It also has toxins, antitoxins, only three of them. We knocked them out. This is work by Brian Conlon, who's now at faculty at Chapel Hill. And what he found is that here's a stationary state killing with antibiotic. There's absolutely no difference between wild type and toxins, antitoxin knockout, the same in exponentially growing cells. So what we learned over a decade of work was completely irrelevant, right? So for understanding persisters in gram-positive bacteria, so we had to start from scratch. And this is what we decided to do. We had, for a variety of reasons, a suspicion that persisters may be cells that are going into stationary state early. And here's a test of that hypothesis. We have this promoter of arginine deaminase, which is expressed in stationary state. You see it's highly expressed in stationary state, poorly expressed in exponential. But there is this small subpopulation of cells in exponential that has stationary levels of expression of that promoter. So we sort out these cells, and these are the only ones that survive a hit by antibiotic. So they are the persisters. And then, of course, the interesting question is, what is it that this promoter is actually measuring. What is it that it is responding to? Okay. So we decided that it responds to ATP. I don't have time to tell you why we decided that, but this is what it does. If you decrease the concentration of ATP using arsenate, then this promoter and a similar one, PKPA, shoot up. So actually, we are measuring ATP, or the low levels of ATP, when we're sorting out persisters. So stochastic variation of ATP apparently is what's responsible for persister formation in staph, and this is very relevant to Borrelia burgdorferi because it has no toxin. It is one of the very rare bacteria that have no toxin antitoxin modules to begin with, so they have to make persisters by a different way, not dependent on toxin antitoxin. So then we decided to revisit what we know about E. coli. We found a similar marker in E. coli that responds to ATP, in this case positively responds. It's the ribosomal promoter. We sort out bright cells. We sort out dim cells in this case, and the dim cells are the only ones that survive a hit by antibiotic. So here we have a revision of what's happening in persisters. It looks like, apart from these specific pathways, which are probably very different in different bacteria, there is this general pathway, which we're now, of course, investigating in Borrelia as well to see if it operates in Borrelia, as it is in unrelated bacteria. And we are, of course, on the hunt for factor X that is responsible for dropping this ATP. Next time, I'll probably tell you what it is. Okay. So another important question regarding persisters that we've been addressing is clinical relevance of persisters to disease. It is hard to do Koch postulates on persisters because a small subpopulation of temporarily dormant cells, you put them in an animal, they wake up, they're not persisters anymore. You cannot do Koch postulates on persisters. So a clue to finding a link between persisters and disease came from an experiment that Pooja Balani, a grad student in my lab, was doing on a very different subject. She was trying to catalog all potential persister genes. And here's a simple experiment that allows you to do that. So you hit a growing population with antibiotic, you collect surviving cells, repeat it a couple of times, and you get an enrichment in mutants, high persister mutants, that make more persister cells, right? Then you can sequence the genomes and find out what those mutations are and what the genes are. So, but then when you look at this experiment, what comes to mind is that this is exactly what happens when patients are treated with antibiotics. They receive periodic high doses of antibiotics, and if being a persister is useful for the pathogen to avoid being killed by antibiotic, you will get selection for high persister mutants. So then we went hunting for such mutants in patients with a relapsing UTI, because we figured that this experiment has already been performed in humans on a massive scale. We just need to look at the results of that experiment. So I'll show you what we found. What we found is primarily an E. coli, a gain-of-function mutation in the HIPA protein that makes it more active and it more efficiently shuts down translation and causes dormancy. And here are these mutants. They make 100 to 1,000 times more persisters than the wild types. So that links persisters to disease and also shows you that there's a separate phenomenon out there. Apart from heritable resistance, there's heritable drug tolerance. Two completely different phenomena, both employed by pathogens to avoid being killed by antibiotics. Okay, and then we decided to check this out in Borrelia burgdorferi. Now, so I asked Lind and Hugh, my collaborator, to give me a collection of Borrelia isolates from patients that have been treated with antibiotics. He said that's not possible for a variety of reasons, many of which you here appreciate. So then we decided to do something different. So from our investigation of E. coli, we were surprised to see that persister mutants come not only from patients treated with antibiotics, but also from commensals. So it looks like in Mother Nature, there are lots of nasty compounds that hit the pathogen and select for hypersensitive mutants. You don't need antibiotic treatment in the clinic to select for them. So then we were thinking maybe the same thing may be happening with Borrelia that infect ticks. And so Sam Telford gave us a collection of Borrelia that we're screening now for the presence of hypersensitive strains. And this is what we're finding so far. So this is the degree of killing by ceftriaxone of these isolates. And you see that this one, for example, is killed very well, but not these. Okay, so this is the same kind of a pattern that we see in E. coli, and we see in all other pathogens that we investigated and published so far. So we published this in M. tuberculosis, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Candida albicans yeast. So it looks like this is a general phenomenon. This may be very relevant to the disease because one of the things that we will be discussing this afternoon is what is PTLDS and how you can predict and link initial infection to who will and who will not develop PTLDS. Well, this is one possible variable that you have. Some people are infected with an easy form of the pathogen and some with a form that will be more difficult to eradicate. So now I want to, from here, want to tell you about the compounds we've been working on in a variety of species to eradicate persisters. I'll start with one compound that we identified, and this is in an effort to eradicate biofilm infections of Staph aureus. Now, eradicating persisters, as you may imagine, is a difficult proposition because these are dormant cells. As I told you, they're not killed by existing antibiotics. And the pathways of their formation are redundant. That means you don't have a drug target, right? So that looks like a perfect dead end for us. But one thing that comes to mind when you see that nature came up with a perfect defense, nature usually comes up with a way against that perfect defense, right? So we started looking among natural products, asking the question, did Mother Nature bother to evolve an anti-persister compound? Knowing what we're looking for a compound that's going to hit an important target in the cell, corrupt it, and kill that cell, and that will require no energy, right? That's the magical compound that we're looking for. But by these criteria, we hit upon this old abandoned antibiotic, acyldepsipeptide. Or ADAP. It does an interesting thing. Its target is the CLIP protease. The CLIP protease normally recognizes misfolded peptides with the aid of this ATP-dependent chaperone, and then it digests them. In the presence of ADAP, the pore of the protease is open, and it can digest peptides without the need for ATP. And that's exactly, of course, what we're looking for. So Brian Conlon investigated this, did a big study, showed by proteome analysis that there's a massive degradation of mature proteins in the presence of ADAP. In Staph, I'll just show you one or two key experiments. Here's a control with stationary Staph aureus, growing Staph aureus here, persisters that are not killed by antibiotic. And if you had ADAP, you get complete sterilization. So that was the first time we saw sterilization of an infection in a test tube, and that was pretty exciting. And then, of course, we did that in an animal model of incurable biofilm infection. This is a neutropenic mouse, incurable thigh infection. Regular antibiotics don't do much. ADAP completely sterilizes. We add rifampicin or another partner antibiotic to prevent the rise of resistant mutants. And so we got a sterile mouse, and this we are developing now. Hopefully it will move into the clinic. So this is encouraging, but unfortunately ADAP has no activity against Borrelia. So here we had to start again from scratch, as you often start in microbiology. And we were looking for vulnerabilities of this pathogen. We have ourselves a list of vulnerabilities. And one thing that is helpful is that the genome is small, so it doesn't have a lot of tricks up its sleeve. The Borrelia actually doesn't with its small genome. So one thing that we were surprised to find is this. If you look at persister formation during, so here's the growth of the culture. So it grows exponentially, then it reaches stationary, non-growing state. And during the time of growth, you can take samples exposed to antibiotics and find out how many cells survive. Those are your persisters. Persisters shoot up from early exponential through mid-exponential. So here the culture stopped growing, right? And there's considerable killing, especially at earlier stationary state, by amoxicillin and by ceftriaxone, enormous killing of stationary state. These are cell wall acting antibiotics. They're not supposed to kill non-growing cells. We've never seen that before with any pathogen. So we're very surprised. Why is it that cell wall acting antibiotics are killing a non-growing cell? So we decided to investigate this. This is work by Wendy Wu in my lab. She's probably somewhere here. So here, first of all, you see how different antibiotics kill stationary cells. Doxycycline, ceftriaxone much better. Vancomycin actually is a terrific anti-Borrelia compound. Okay, so that is also something to keep in mind. But it does not sterilize. But still, you know, enormous killing. So here is an experiment showing you label incorporation, fluorescent label incorporation into peptidoglycan. This is growing Borrelia. The green label incorporates, of course, especially you see lots of label at the ends. And this is stationary. And you see that there is significant label incorporation into stationary cells. Here's the middle of the cell. So in the middle of the cell, lots of incorporation of peptidoglycan. This is an ungrowing culture, but it continues to synthesize peptidoglycan, and that's apparently why it is vulnerable. Here is a quantitative measure of that same experiment. So here is, by comparison, Staph aureus. Growing Staph aureus, very little label incorporation to stationary Staph aureus. And here's Borrelia. Here's Borrelia lock. Not that much of a difference in Borrelia stationary. So here is the interesting vulnerability, the anomaly of this pathogen that we should definitely exploit. Okay, so the other thing that we've been thinking about is how can we eradicate persisters completely with something like a cell wall acting antibiotic? This is work by Bijaya Sharma. She's now a postdoc in Lyndon Hughes' lab. So the simple idea was to hit the population with antibiotic. Persisters survive. And then you wash away the antibiotic, allow persisters to wake up, but not to repopulate the population. And you hit it with antibiotic again. And of course, since they woke up, there are less of them. So you get a drop. You repeat it two more times, and you get complete sterilization, right? With a compound that itself does not sterilize. We did that because, of course, we were thinking that in the body, the drug will be cleared from the system. And you could, if you can hit upon the correct pulse dosing, you can probably eradicate in a chronic infection with a compound that does not necessarily itself sterilizes. So we're now doing this experiment in mice, and we're following to see if we achieved complete eradication, and hopefully if that works, we can do that in humans as well. Okay, apart from that, the last thing that I'm going to tell you about is that we have also a drug discovery project. This is also a work that is performed mainly by Wendy Wu. So we have a screen for compounds that inhibit growth of Borrelia. We started with a pilot screen. Now we screened such pilot screens. Now make up a bigger one, and our initial hits were, you know, reasonably 0.45% hit rate. So we were looking for compounds that specifically act against Borrelia, don't act against other bacteria. If you do that, that gives you an immediate advantage, because then that is a strong indication that your compound is not going to be toxic, because we usually do not have that kind of a target. So with that logic, we found something interesting. Apart from these 20 compounds, we found this compound. It also showed up and was published recently in a screen that was performed by the Stanford group of Rajadan and his co-authors. So here's this compound. This is disulfiram. Normally, disulfiram is used to treat alcoholism. well, it doesn't treat it, right? But it prevents people from drinking alcohol, right? Because it's anti-abuse. It's called anti-abuse because it inhibits this step in ethanol degradation. On the way from ethanol to acetate to carbon dioxide and water, there is this nasty compound, acetaldehyde, which is toxic. And it is detoxified by acetyl dehydrogenase, acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. And that's what the disulfiram inhibits, so you get a horrible hangover. And, you know, it's unlikely that you're going to drink alcohol a second time. Disulfiram is highly active against Borrelia burgdorferi, has no activity against other pathogens that we tested, so it's specific against Borrelia. And here, if you look at this ranking of antibiotics, here is very interesting. Disulfiram completely sterilizes Borrelia burgdorferi. It kills persisters. We are looking into the mechanism of this. This is quite unexpected. But the compound is, of course, approved. It's very safe. And so we're gearing up to do mouse studies to see if we can cure a mouse of Lyme disease. And then this becomes a very interesting candidate to treat Lyme in people. Okay, so with that, thanks to my team, to my collaborators and to support, and I thank you for listening.
I'll be very loud. Jim, could you perhaps hypothesize as to why Borrelia is particularly targeted with this pathway, with this drug? Does it, you know, what is it? Is it alcohol producer or something?
That's an excellent question. Well, it is an anaerobe, so maybe that's why it's particularly vulnerable. Interestingly, it does not have a recognizable homolog of acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. Of course, that's the first thing that we checked. So our simple hypothesis is that it probably has an enzyme that we did not recognize in our database. So, but, you know, we'll figure out what it is.
So, I'm sorry. So the question was about low-dose penicillin administered as weekly bicillin injections. Sometimes we see failures of IV antibiotics and other regimens, and all of a sudden we switch the patient to a single injection a week, and the patient recovers. And the question is whether in all this hunt for the persister killing, whether there is any suggestion that there is a chemo detection, some sort of chemo detection by the microorganism, which enables it to transform into a persister, into a, you know, we know that there are naked forms that are dropping the cell wall, therefore the cell wall antibiotics won't work.
Yeah.
And the question whether this low dosing evades the chemo detection and therefore might offer a killing, effective killing and prevention of forming persisters.
Yeah, that's a good question. So one thing that you notice from these biphasic killing curves is that in the presence of antibiotics, persisters do not die. Once you take away the antibiotic at fresh media, allow them to wake at Riada antibiotic, they do die. The fact that they do not die in the presence of antibiotic means that they're not waking up, right? So they are probably sensing the presence of antibiotic, and paradoxically, the antibiotic prevents them from effectively waking up. And that's one of the, definitely one of the things that is potentially one can exploit to find out what that is and eradicate persisters.
Just to go on that question of the disulfiram, do you see any difference between the B31 and any of the clinical isolates, either with disulfiram or some of your other drugs as well?
I'm sorry, between what?
B31 and clinical isolates?
For disulfiram. We haven't done that yet. So we are definitely are planning to test our whole panel with disulfiram.
I have a question on as we've seen in with other microbes, the influence of particular thinking about the case of E. coli, where a bacteriophage in one case was dropping in things like methyltransferases and reprogramming E. coli to become virulent and things like that. But do you see, or have you seen any evidence of the other part of the microbiome, the viruses or bacteriophage, adding some variability to either whether resistance or or virulence or anything like that?
Inverella. Yeah, yeah. We have not seen it. Again, it keeps a very small genome.
Yeah.
It does not take up foreign DNA very easily. For example, I don't think that anyone has described Borrelia that carries a transmissible drug resistance marker. Determinant. And then another thing about Borrelian resistance that is useful to keep in mind is that the disease is apparently not transmissible between humans. So that means that every human is a dead end in a way. So even if with a low probability resistance will develop in that patient, it's not going to be transmissible, because it is the transmission of resistance that is the main problem. For current drugs. And that's why I think we can, with relative impunity, think about, you know, pulse dosing antibiotics and not worrying too much about the probability of resistance spreading.
Have you tested any of the differences in geographic strains?
Not yet, no. But if you have a collection, I will test it.
That's actually a good lead into my next question was, so we have clinicians and people collecting big samples, and from your perspective, you know, based on what you showed or maybe something you didn't show, if you had an iPhone app that made Mark do whatever you told him to do, or anyone else, what are the experiments that we should be running, maybe as a consortia or something, that aren't being run right now, but from your perspective need to be done? Do anything come to mind?
Well, the simple survey of, the relative level of persisters in different isolates, that would be very nice to know. How prevalent are apparent hypersister mutants? And then can we link that causally to the probability of developing PTLDS? That would be a terrific question to ask. Another good question to ask is any experimental or very highly effective drug that we see that eradicates Borrelia, like vancomycin or disulfiram, how broadly applicable that is to a large number of strains.
Yeah.
Have there been any, based on what the last results that you were indicating, have there been any attempts to use disulfiram, which I believe is available, it can be to use it in clinical populations and see what happens?
Well, that's exactly what we're gearing up to. So we're running a mouse study. First of all, we want to see if it cures uncomplicated acute infection in the mouse. Yes?
I guess I meant not that you were doing directly through mouse studies and the normal progression there, but individuals who are having serious problems with Lyme and it's a relatively safe drug, I believe, although I'm not.
Yes, it is fairly safe, yes.
So are individuals separate from you attempting to see whether it has an impact clinically before the animal studies are completed?
That's an interesting question. Sure, one could conceivably, put it right into people. You know, why bother with mice? Yeah, you could do that. We're also running a retrospective study with Chris Patel, with Chirag Patel from Harvard School of Public Health. So he has access to medical records of 20% of American people. He's actually not unique in that. Just keep in mind that information is out there. And so he is asking a question about correlates between Lyme disease and a number of other things, including, of course, whether taking disulfiram is good for you when you are bitten by a tick.
I was wondering a little bit about persisters. So how specific to a given environment is a persistent strain? I mean, so for instance, if you're a persister in I don't know, I mean, in one host, you know, under a certain antibiotic condition, would you be persistent in another host as well, for instance?
Right. Well, the one important factor that determines the level of persisters is the growth phase. There's almost no persisters formed in early exponential, and then that probability increases about 1,000-fold as the population approaches stationary. And that's a universal determinant, and it looks like all other determinants are relatively minor by comparison to that one.
Okay, so if I understand you properly, then basically, if you're a persister in one environment, for instance, a persister in, you know, in an animal model, you'll also be a good persister in a human or human cells,
yes,
or that sort of thing. Okay.
Dr. Lewis, often patients are infected with more than one organism, and that seems to also be a cause for ongoing symptoms and difficulty with the cure. So I'm wondering, did you consider testing mice with not just Lyme disease, but adding another pathogen to see if the disulfiram worked? Thank you.
That's an excellent question. You know, we're starting with something simple. You know, I like, so Joel likes to work with massive data and very complex systems. I like to work with one thing at a time, right? So probably that's why we're collaborating with Joel. But we'll certainly add that once we figure out what's happening in a simpler system.
Thank you.
Not every day we get the opportunity to have somebody of your caliber talking to clinicians, and there are, you know, several perhaps mythologies in Lyme treatment, and I want perhaps your, you know, your authoritative statement to break down those mythologies. For example, the Lyme community has been talking for ages about cysts and cyst busters. Are these the persisters?
That's a complicated question. We are investigating that now, but I think we have also an afternoon panel where we will be discussing, you know, things like you are alluding to, breaking down barriers, and where are the really the questions, the burning questions, or the unanswered questions that we need to attack. So we'll probably do all that later today.
Thank you.
Since we have a little time, I guess I got another question on here. From the work, I know you focus very much on the microbe, but you know, what sort of hints or hypotheses are coming up in terms of even from a drug drug administration standpoint, modulating the host immune system or the role of the host immune system?
Right.
In the progression of the disease?
Yeah, sure. So we gave that a considerable amount of thought. Modulating the immune system directly is very tricky, but there is a very good and fairly benign way to modulate the immune system, and that is through altering the microbiome. And again, one of the things that I would like to discuss this afternoon is microbiome intervention into autoimmune disease type presentation.
Mr. Carl, that question, what is the impact of the immune system on the development of persisters?
Well, I would say that, so one thing that the immune system does, the innate immune system produces reactive oxygen species. So we've shown in vitro that at least in E. coli, reactive oxygen species can induce persister formation. There's been a belief in the tuberculosis field that the immune system keeps persisters in check because, you know, if you have latent TB and then you get, let's say, HIV, you get a flare-up of the disease. So that is indirect information on at least that case of latent disease. But apart from that, not that much is known.
Thanks. We're running a bit ahead of schedule, which isn't a bad thing, as you know, because certainly we'll be biting into this time here as we go on. But I think at this point, we'd like to bring up the first panel, which is the Big Data and Systems Medicine panel. All right. So our first panel here. So as I mentioned at the beginning, we're going to do things a little bit differently. We're going to give each person on the panel 5 minutes or so to introduce themselves and, of course, a big idea that they want to convey to hopefully seed the discussion that we're going to have here amongst the panelists. But I'll just do a brief introduction. So we have Stephen Schutzer, the physician scientist from Rutgers. And for lack of a better word, we put him on this panel as a wild card, which maybe is not a fair thing to say. But that in particular, he's a someone who's doing great work in Lyme, but is seeking to benefit from big data. So not a computational person himself, but definitely generating the types of information and has the types of questions that could benefit from big data. We have Rob Moritz from Institute for Systems Biology in Seattle. Has done a lot of great work in proteomics and not only in Lyme's disease, but beyond. Andy Kogelnik, known him for a long time. Hope it's okay to call you Andy. But at the Open Medicine Institute, again, another physician scientist working in Lyme and also has a background in strong background in informatics and quantitative skills. And then Brian Kidd, who's an assistant professor, director of Systems Medicine Center here at Mount Sinai, leading the Lyme efforts from our part. So right now, I'm going to pass this down and give you each 5 minutes to convey your big idea.
So it's nice to be up here with this panel. I'm not a physician, although I'm a doctor, and it was so exciting when I got my PhD, and my mom said, yeah, you're a doctor now, but not the kind that can help anyone. So it's... So hopefully I've moved a little bit beyond that with a lot of my efforts. And what I wanted to highlight, or at least to start with, is Joel had mentioned this idea of next generation sequencing and how the technology has really brought this watershed of data readily available. So we're no longer hypothesis or data limited. It's really our creativity and what can we collect and how do we analyze it. And this slide that I'm showing that may be difficult to see from the back, but this was an article published actually by one of our colleagues, Charles Chu and Joe DeRisi, they're both at UCSF. This was actually one of the best examples of applying next generation sequencing to work on a very difficult problem. And what's shown along this timeline is this is actually a child who has severe immunocompromised and was infected with something that they didn't know about and went through a round of fevers over the course of 2 years or maybe a year and a half, and they actually was hospitalized 3 times, and by the third time they were sort of at wit's end and didn't know what to do, so they applied next generation sequencing. And what you can see up here is in the period of about 2 days, they really cranked through all the data and actually found this was an unknown viral infection that they could not detect by normal means, and decided to actually administer treatment without getting the final say, or the final confirmation from other methods. And in the course of the next few weeks, then this child's fever came down and was actually able to leave the hospital. But this was really kudos to the effort of, next generation sequencing and going from this timeline down in this period here that's highlighted of a few days, just cranking through all the data. And so what can we do with all this data? And what I want to point out with regards to Lyme, so we, work in a hospital, we see, to put this in perspective, the number of new cases for a cancer, multiple myeloma, is the same each year as the number of new cases of Lyme, about 25 to 30,000 new, diagnosed Lyme cases confirmed. But you can see that the number of actual studies and people working on this, it's about fourfold as many. And if we go forward, that translates to 4 to 5-fold as much data on the problem. And what we've been able to do with cancer is actually generate these models from these data to offer really precise treatment and individualized care based on their genomics and transcriptional profiling. What we would like to do, and what we're hoping to do, is do the same with Lyme, and the efforts for that would be around collecting more data and generating these models that would allow real insights into actionable items for treatments and diagnostics. Thanks.
So I am a physician, and I still see patients. I'm also a data nerd like Joel. So Joel and I went through, well, actually, I didn't do my PhD at Stanford. I did my PhD at Georgia Tech while I was doing my MD, but Joel and I were at Stanford together for a while working in the same lab and share a lot of that same perspective that he already started on this morning. And when I was getting ready to leave Stanford, I was sitting at a cafe with Joel one day, and we were talking about how to get access to more data and how to open up things. And I think it was actually he who coined our institute, Open Medicine Institute, Institute's name. And here we are 5 years later, so it's kind of nice to come full circle on that. But what we've been doing, sort of a Stanford breakout, is going at some of the sources of the data that Brian just talked about, and it's particularly important for chronic and invisible illnesses like Lyme disease, where if you go into the EMR data, you know, as a computer scientist, one of the first things you learn is garbage in, garbage out. And that's a huge problem in Lyme disease. That's one of the reasons why the case definitions the case frequency got upped from 30,000 to 300,000, and is probably still an underestimate. If you look in the EMR data, you won't find a whole lot of people with an ICD-9 code for Lyme disease, or at least you won't find a representative sample unless you're at Johns Hopkins and John is dutifully coding those, but most of the institutions aren't coding them correctly. So we went out into the community and started measuring those in the places where patients were being treated by docs for persistent chronic illnesses and lots of other things as well, and sort of took a longitudinal approach on how do we gather as much data as we possibly can, whether it's wearable devices, these large-scale genomic arrays, single-cell gene expression, and really track that over time and look at how are these patients changing. Regardless of what else we know about them, there are patients in the community that are getting better. And we haven't historically done a great job at measuring those, but they're also in the same cohorts. There are patients who don't respond to the same antibiotics. So what's going on in those patients, and how can we, I'll come back to the slide in a second, how can we track them over time, similar to the slide that Brian was just showing. We can track patients on a lot of parameters, and this is just a few. Actually, some of these bars represent tens of thousands of data points on some of these patients. This is actually my friend Larry Smarr, who we collaborate with a lot on microbiome work, and some of the clinical parameters, as well as laboratory parameters, as well as actually omic measurements in him, and we can do this for lots of patients, and indeed that's what we're doing across chronic fatigue syndrome, Lyme disease, IBD, IBS, all kinds of chronic diseases that have some level of interaction with the immune system. And I think this is a really critical tool because patients are getting better in the community, and we can measure that, and we can take things like what Kim just suggested, disulfiram, which I'm pretty sure is not going to be in any data set congruent with a Lyme patient, or at least it won't have been recorded that way, but that's actually becomes a really simple trial to do, to take a drug off the shelf and implement it in a nationwide or even an international clinical trial. So we actually have an informatics infrastructure in the community where we can pull together EMR data direct from patient data, from mobile devices, from wearables, and put that together with lots of different places. And I just want to highlight one aspect of this is actually the insurance data gets really interesting. So we've actually aligned ourselves as a wellness and disease management program with a number of insurers. And at first pass, you ask, well, why would you want to do that? You know, half of them don't even recognize chronic disease. Well, exactly. We went in, and in our first group, we looked at about a population of about 30,000 people, and we said, well, of your $140 million healthcare expenditure for the year, what are the top categories? What are the top complaints? Well, chronic pain, non-traumatic chronic pain, turned out to be number two, which was very unexpected to them. And well, we know a little bit about chronic pain. Well, there's a lot of pain involved in Lyme disease. There's pain involved in fibromyalgia. There's pain involved in chronic fatigue syndrome, on down the list. And so you can go in and actually cull out these populations. It turned out that level of pain was worth $14 million to that population of 30,000 people in 1 year, every year, repeated year after year after year. So there's a resource that if you can have an impact on clinically, and you can take samples from that population, which we've been doing periodically now, and relate them back to your Lyme clinic patients and your other patients, you start to get some really interesting comparative data, and we're actually starting to see some of that now on the treatment side, what happens when we treat patients and they go in the right direction versus going in the wrong direction. You can see their omic profiles changing. And I think I'm probably out of time, so I will turn it over to Dr. Moritz.
Okay. So, you know, Joel's been a wonderful friend of ISB, and some of the things that they're all doing together is making sure that data sets are actually statistically valid, and that's one of the biggest things that comes with big data. And for an example, I just want to give to you a picture of what some people always call the poor cousin at the moment. You know, genomics has really taken over the field. Everyone can do genomic measurements quite easily. They can send it off in the mail and get their big results back. But when it comes to actually looking at the business end of the diseases, it always comes back to proteins. And as we saw in the last talk, the major component there is seeing where drugs interact with proteins. So you really need to know what your proteins are and really at what quantitation as well. So with the human proteome, there's been a large effort to try and get to a point where we can understand all the different proteins. And so the big question is, are we actually there yet? And we're getting to a point now where we can at least put together a parts list of all of the proteins, and this goes for either human or any other organism as well, but then also understanding now what the protein forms are and ultimately their functions, and that's really which is currently being done at an accelerated pace. But what comes with big data, though, is literature that one has to always take into consideration to say, is it actually correct? So there's been two efforts. One has been a large effort by what we call the Human Proteome Organization to understand all of the proteins from each of the chromosomes. And there was also a couple of papers that came out in 2014 that actually said that this was the draft of the human proteome. So I just want to set the stage with that one initially. Our group, over the last couple of years, have been presenting papers each year by year where we take all of the public data, we take all of our own data, we combine that together, and we present that to the world as a resource in which people can actually see where all of the proteins are being detected. Currently, we're using technologies such as mass spectrometry, but this will also change as we go forward as well. But over the years, we've really only been at 50%, 60%, 70%, and then more recently, we showed that we're up there just a little over 70%. So it came as a bit of a quandary. What happens when someone presents data as a draft? And we saw that, and one of the biggest questions was how correct is that data? And so when we looked at the two public data sets that came out from the Nature papers, we said, well, here's a couple of proteins that we can actually have a look at, and said they have a lot of peptides, those, and we can actually define those. And we looked in our own data sets, we said that we missed that data. And so we started to develop what we had in our own institute called the SRM Atlas, where we synthesized peptides to every human protein and analyzed them by mass spectrometry. And so lo and behold, we had peptides to those particular proteins. So we can now compare data. And when we look at the two data sets, one's from a German group and the other one's from a US group, and we look at the fragmentation profile, so the uninitiated, it looks quite well. And then you also look at the other data set, and they also have a set of fragmentation data, and it also looks reasonable, but the questions are is what the quality of that data is, and that's where it comes into play of a statistical validation. So when we looked at a synthetic peptide, the fragmentation pattern looked completely different, and so this is a synthetic peptide, it should be correct, and so why are those two data sets completely different? So when you compare those, you start to see why. Is the tools that are being used are being over-simplified, and the statistical validation is not there. And that's why when people start to talk about big data sets, we really need to look at the statistical validation on top of those as well. And so we compare those data sets, we see vastly different profiles, and so one really needs to bring those into play. But some of the efforts that we're doing at ISB is developing these large atlases to which we can now create assays to every protein of an organism. We have one which we just released two months ago called the Human SRM Atlas. We're also working with Borrelia and releasing a database pretty soon, which will be a full quantitative database on all proteins that we can define both in the Borrelia chromosome, but also in its plasmids as well, and understanding the quantitative differences between each of those. And so we can hopefully now present that data for people to look at the protein level, which we believe is be the actionable level of Borrelia and Lyme disease, and move on from there.
Thank you. That's good. I didn't have to go into the technical aspects. Thanks for having me. So I'm talking today on neuroproteomics. So we took advantage of having very high resolution mass spectrometry and separation techniques. And so we use proteomics as sort of the quickest way to get to where we want to go. So we use an unbiased mass spectrometry protein separation, so we're calling proteomics. Many people will recognize a Western blot as proteomics, but that's a little dated. So this is the best way to get a blueprint, and when you have a roadmap, then you can get to new therapies. You can dissect it out and see how to get from one point to the other. So that would be a discovery phase. And you can take that, and if you're now looking for biomarkers, you can take the same list of proteins and do targeted analysis now that you know what to look for. And you can verify in individual samples which proteins may be diagnostic for the disease. Thanks. And then, so for example, how quick this has gone or how deep is you can interrogate a single spinal fluid sample, in our case, to detect 300 proteins at once, if they were there. So we started with spinal fluid because it's the liquid window of the brain. And so that's the best way, short of a brain biopsy, to go find this. And once we find it, then we could look into the blood, which is more of a complex mess, unless you know what you're looking for. And these proteins may also have prognostic value, whether you're going to go on to have persistent disease or recover. We don't know that yet. That's in the future. So when we do this, we look for both what is there and what's not there. And to do this, you get into complex bioinformatics. And it's not that hard, but then we want to extend it out. And this is the purpose, I think, of this endeavor, this conference, is to then say, okay, we have this on individual patients. We have it, but what is their clinical data exactly? When do they get the disease? Where do they get it? How do they manifest it? Did they have erythema migrans? Did they not have it? Which antibiotics they have? So this is how big data comes into play. And we often hear what's termed anecdotal information about individual patients or patients, but harnessing it in the rubric of big data will help us dissect out and help us move forward. So that's where we're going on this. Thanks, Joel. And then, so I want to say that we used just to let some of the people in the audience, like Brian, we used Brian Fallon's patients for the complex post-treatment Lyme disease syndrome. We used Ben Nadelson's patients at chronic fatigue, and we had our own normals. And we gathered in, we were able to dissect out about 600 proteins that seem to be unique to Lyme disease in the cerebral spinal fluid. And they're not shared in plasma, they're unique to brain. So we're moving forward on that. And you know, we're glad we had funding from LRA and NIH to push us along in this.
All right, thanks. So I think one good question to get started for this panel is, you know, what are some examples of where, maybe not in Lyme, but in other diseases where, you know, so-called big data has had an impact already? You know, with any new technology, there's a lot of hype, and the hype, the reality has, you know, some time to catch up with the hype, but are there lessons or examples from other diseases where clearly having, you know, big data, big public data has already had a big impact on the disease? Does anyone want to take that on?
Well, I think this is one of the problems in invisible illnesses in general, that there aren't, as you already highlighted, a lot of big public data sets. You know, we've been involved in one effort around chronic fatigue syndrome that's been sponsored by the CDC, but even that data, it's a 6-year project collecting
longitudinal samples over lots of patients, about 1,000 patients. And that data isn't publicly available, but it's actually available through CDC at the moment and has been used to actually promote that cause from sort of the lowly level it was at up through the ranks, that it's now gotten some attention at the IOM level, Institute of Medicine level, and now from NIH as well. And I think some of that same process the Lyme community can learn from. But I think there is momentum in the community to build these sets. You know, we and other groups have started on that route, but I think one of the keys to this is actually bringing these groups together in a multi-center kind of way that everybody can be collecting in a similar way so that we can have that cross-sectionality. One of the biggest dangers, like I said, junk, garbage in, garbage out. Mm-hmm. For omic technologies, some of them are not compatible at the end of the day, as you know. And so putting those data sets together might not actually make sense. So we should think about that now as we start collecting more and more of these, that we can align different paths so we can utilize some of that power of big data.
Sure. I guess I would add, one of the areas that big data has really shined has been in cancer. The example that I guess I'll talk a little bit more about later, but some of our efforts around personalized medicine, having actually there's been large efforts in cancer over the last 30 years to really, it was one of the first adopters of big data, genomics. It was very clear that genomics was a driver of cancer, and so by putting lots of samples, making them available, making all of the data sort of shared among large groups, we now have large reference sets. We are able to do statistical validation of a lot of these data sets and uncover either new drivers of cancer that have spurred complete new therapeutics or even ways in which we treat patients here as in our oncology. So I think cancer has been probably the poster child. I would also say that infectious disease, especially with a lot of the example I showed, the ability to actually diagnose rapidly, so it's been more of a access to data in an unbiased way, because you often you'll find what you go looking for, and one of the challenges, I guess, to big data and unbiased sort of systems approaches where you just do a survey is it's a fishing expedition. And in some cases, those fishing expeditions prove to be quite useful. And infectious disease and cancer have been two areas where I think big data has really advanced how we think about the problem and how we're actually thinking about treating patients.
I think one of the biggest examples at the moment is this revolution in wellness. Currently, we're able to do a lot of different omics measurements, and one of the programs we have going at ISB is a wellness component, which is also spun out of company at the moment. And this has allowed people to really look deeply into their own health and then start to interrogate the physicians themselves. I think this was really started by Larry Smarr. I think we've mentioned him before and some of the things that he's done, but also people like Mike Snyder, who's done his personalome some years ago, and he's continued to follow that on. But this has now spawned on a whole industry that is looking at personalized wearables in which people can monitor their status all the time. But this, the access to the data, also brings on a lot of complications as well, because one needs to now have to take all that information together in a big type data environment, integrate that information to come back as an actual component. But you can already see with some of these programs going forward and companies that have spun out, such as Arival from ISB, that there are immediate actionable components that can go through that people are just not aware of their current health status, and they can get immediate implications coming back to them and actually go back to their doctors and say, look, I think we really need to look at this a little bit deeper. And so it's really turning the world upside down. I thought there was an image on the front of the book that the patient now says to the doctor that I'm ready to see you now.
I think there's a dark side to that too. As a clinician, I can say I've sat in my office and had patients walk in and say, with their hard drive, say, doc, here's my genome, what do I do now, right? And what do I do with that information, right? A, in the short time you have with a patient, you can't digest that. B, the cost of the genome might be down to about $1,000, but interpreting it becomes a huge problem, as Dr. Moritz already highlighted. So that's an interface that I think is going to change dynamically in the next 5 years, and is actually really important for all chronic diseases, but particularly for misdiagnosed ones like Lyme disease. So you have all this data, and how does the clinician start to digest that? We've spent a lot of time trying to develop tools to sort of summarize some of that information. I think Arvale and other efforts have as well in certain contexts. So sort of the idea of dashboarding, which is very popular now around big data, but in some ways that's making big data small, again, so it's digestible by the clinician. But it's an interesting dichotomy that I think is evolving quickly.
Just in general, we sort of anticipate some of the problems like Andy said. So when we started with looking at neurological diseases, we took MS, we took other diseases, we made sure that we had samples that were well characterized for the purpose of what we were doing. And so once we had that, then we could do our best to do the proteomics. And each other neurological associated disease or neuropsychiatric one, we enter into it, we end up benefiting each other disease we analyze because it's now more specific. And technically, when we first began, we had to use a pool because it cost like about over $100,000 per sample run. So that's not ready for someone to send into Quest Diagnostics and get the test. But now things have gotten better where we can multiplex them and get about 10 samples for the same thing by some techniques, labeling them differently. So it's like the human genome, things are getting cheaper. But again, we're using it for a discovery thing so you could translate it into a simplistic test. But once we have that, you know, this is like funneling it down. Once we have what we think is a considerably good database or representative thing, then we could expand it out to the larger population. That's where having both big data and the accompanying bioinformatic ability to analyze this massive data is a big help.
So another question I'd like to pose is, you know, we talked about with cancer and in other areas, there's already been big investments and there's big developments in so-called, you know, big data technologies and other diseases. You know, Lyme, I think we can all appreciate, is a little bit behind on that just for a number of reasons. The nature of the disease, the nature of funding, et cetera. But, you know, do we have to start from scratch in Lyme disease, or are there other resources that have already been developed through other efforts that we can pull in to Lyme to sort of catch up and really accelerate the adoption of, you know, so-called big data approaches in Lyme disease? Or do we, you know, or do we have to start fresh?
Well, I mean, I think the ecosystem around biotechnology is constantly evolving, and I think a lot of the tools that have been developed for the Human Genome Project, for various cancer efforts and so forth, a lot of them are very relevant to measuring things in Lyme disease. We've seen a huge benefit from looking at metabolomics, single cell gene expression, so sort of immune profiling type of stuff, and I think Bill Robinson's going to talk at some of the stuff they found at Stanford, and you know Mark Davis's group has found some stuff as well. So we actually have a big project right now where we've leveraged a whole bunch of technologies like that, where we're measuring several hundred people immunologically, so we're sort of profiling them over time as they go through, you know, getting these conditions, and then hopefully down the right treatment pathways. But we'll be able to measure that. But that's an example of a project that wouldn't have been possible even 4 years ago. Because these technologies are evolving so quickly. So absolutely, I think there are lots of tools that can be brought in from other areas. And it's not just about identifying the Lyme pathogen in that patient's sample. It's about identifying and understanding, as Kim alluded to, their immune response and how they're going to deal with that infection and what drugs can potentially help them or hurt them in dealing with that infection.
I guess I would add to that, you know, there's one thing we've been fairly successful at is taking the comparative approach. You know, what does this look like? Where in the space of diseases, you know, Joel showed this network of where does Lyme sit in the constellation? And that has been really helpful for repurposing approaches. You know, if this looks like another infectious disease, if this looks like another chronic disease, you know, maybe it shares
pathways within the immune system or mechanisms by which the immune system is trying to combat the disease. And so, you know, we could kind of leapfrog that. The other thing is, you know, there's two kind of general approaches. You can go kind of small data, very intensive, N of one, where you take, like with Mike Snyder, the narcissome, where he measured all these parameters on himself over time. Or you can take the sort of cancer approach or these, you know, genetic genome-wide association where you'll get hundreds of thousands of patients, you know, whether this is for schizophrenia or various cancers, and just do genetics on them. So you only know genetics, but you know it across a very large population. And I think the, you know, we can take advantage of both of those efforts where we have, you know, a large pool of genetics that we can potentially borrow from, and like what's in the wild, what are the variants that might speak for, you know, susceptibility to disease, but then taking the technologies that have become cheap enough to profile among, whether it be proteins, genes, cells, and so forth, in a smaller set of individuals to actually get a more comprehensive picture of disease that would be more productive potentially in Lyme.
No, I think Lyme is coming in at a really opportune time because with all the developments in the omics tools and big data, it always relies on having a number of specific questions to be asked. And I think with Lyme taking advantage now of all of those tools, we have a point in time which it doesn't have to be subjected to all of the problems that started with all of the developments, but it actually takes advantages of all of those tools, and it really just requires funding. But I think the community at the moment is well organized to a point where everyone is sharing data and also sharing the materials at the moment as well. And I think as long as that is maintained, that you get a lot of benefit out of not only the work that's being done previously for you know, agnostically for other diseases, but also within the environment that we're in at the moment, that Lyme can actually, or Borrelia, the understanding of the interactions of Borrelia can really take advantage of all of the tools and the big data that we are able to develop. And I think with all of the bioinformatics and statistical approaches on top of that, we really can get a lot of traction very quickly.
I would just echo that. It's sometimes it's an advantage to be so old that you're new, and so a lot of the diagnostics really need an overhaul. And I think with new tools, people are ready to do that. I think scientists and I think clinicians get excited about new tools. So it's really a great opportunity to do this, and you know, it's nice to have collaborators meet new ones, and you know, we have groups closer to their area, like Dick Smith's group at Pacific Northwest, which I forgot to mention, who's a leader in proteomics and mass spectrometry. And so, but we also need the cooperation of clinicians and those who are sort of out there, and they're not necessarily communicating with us or a central point, because they just become anecdotal information and it goes wasted information. Some may be valid, some may not be valid, or not get substantiated, but if we don't know about it, we can't critically analyze it.
So just a few more questions before I open it to the audience here, but we've talked a bit about, you know, using big data, informatics, computational biology to get new insights, you know, into the biology of the disease and maybe how the disease progresses. But the other side of big data is also doing better science and reproducibility, right? And just making sure that we're getting better data. You know, reminds me of the famous, you know, paper from John Ioannidis that all published research findings are false, right? That because, you know, when we have a new technology, you have the winner's curse, right? And people who want to publish first with a new tool, you know. But the question is, how can, you know, big data approaches help us do better science in Lyme and improve the way that we even run experiments or collect data on patients?
Well, I think what's really exciting now, and there's a lot of efforts around sharing data, making both the protocols, you know, with computational work and big data, you can make everything public. You know, we've published papers where we made the code completely available so that it's relatively easy for someone to reproduce your work. And you know, if it's digital, you know, you don't have the cost of reagents and other things. So you know, you can download it to your computer, rerun the analyses, do them your whatever way. And so I think that this era of really sharing data, making data sets completely available for everyone, allows for all kinds of new tests to say, okay, we can leave part of this data out, come up with hypotheses, then test it on that data. You know, we've seen there's been, in many ways, a lot of misstarts, especially in the area of cancer. Early on, there were a lot of things that didn't turn out to be so correct. And that was, part of it was firewall and not sharing data. Part of it was just not having enough data to statistically validate the findings and say, you know, is this true? And we've seen this in some clinical trials even as well. So I think that, you know, as everything is moving toward being digital, it becomes really easy. You know, it's harder to hide any sort of mistakes. And it's not that people were being shady before, but I think, you know, we're all trying to do right for patients and make this, you know, really what is the truth? What do we understand about disease? Are we being critical about does this work or does this not work? And with it being open, it provides sort of a fair shake at testing those models out.
I think one of the key issues too is making sure that that data and those data sets that are collected have both clinical relevance and validation after the fact. And I think that we've just started nibbling at that in Lyme disease. So getting out to those community providers and building consortia, including them, becomes key. And characterizing, the second thing would be characterizing the heterogeneity of these populations, because, you know, when all of us talk about Lyme disease, you know, very quickly, and there was already one question about it comes up, you know, what about co-infections? What about the state of the immune system and so on? And so, you know, one of the big questions out there at the molecular level is, you know, can we group patients together? Can we lump them into specific clusters? You know, why do certain people get sicker than others? I mean, I'm doing my own narcissosome as we do these different experiments, and I can tell you that I'm positive for actually a wide range of tick-borne illnesses, including some of the Lyme assays, but I'm pretty sure I don't have Lyme. So why is that my immune system is doing something different? And I've had, my family is from Austria, so I run around in the woods in Europe. I grew up in New Jersey. I worked on Martha's Vineyard for a year. So I've had plenty of chance for exposure. And now I'm in California, where we also have ticks. But something is different in different people's immunology, and we haven't done a lot to characterize that yet. So I think that's part of this process too, which comes back to the first point of making sure it's clinically relevant.
Well, you know, we would like to build a study around you. I mean, this sounds, you know, true. Every omic we can possibly do in imaging, that would be great. So, no, I think. You know, I think as we're doing things, we could also look outward. The more we pour into this and the better job we do, it may help other diseases, because we look at common features of, let's say, post-treatment Lyme disease syndrome, where it's fatigue and cognitive problems. Well, fatigue's so common to cancer and other diseases, so sometimes looking at one that maybe began as an infection will benefit other conditions, so that's something we should keep in mind too.
I'm happy to remain a healthy control. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm happy to remain a healthy control.
Yeah. Okay. So I have other questions, but I want to give a chance for the. Is there anyone in the audience that has any questions for this panel? We've got a bunch here.
Thank you. So one question I have, and it sort of reflects my little soapbox, is that. There's an incredible push to look at big data in patient populations, and I understand and I see the value in it absolutely, and it is required. However, we've heard multiple times the garbage in, garbage out analogy, and I would say that we obviously, the technology and our ability to sequence has well outpaced our ability to understand the data. I think that's a fair statement. So I'm wondering whether a certain amount of deconvoluting at the onset wouldn't help, and I would like to refer to animal models as a much simpler way in which one can approach some of these problems, because some of the complexities are taken out, such as the huge variation in age, sex, previous exposure to various things are much better defined, not completely, but much better defined. So I'm wondering why the same amount of push on big data that is currently applied to human samples are not really reflected in what we see in using animal samples, experimentally infected animals, as well as those that are naturally infected and might, you know, not have quite that complexity.
I'll dive in on that one. I think my experimental animal is the human, and there's a good reason for that. There's actually a lot of papers, and there's some beautiful ones from about 4 or 5 years ago out of Stanford, showing actually a disconnect when they went to look at mouse data and what that represented in terms of gene expression and other things in the human. And so I think it's really important to keep those things in mind. I'm all for animal trials and so forth, particularly around the kinds of things that Dr. Lewis talked about this morning. But I think you have to keep in mind the end application. Things don't always translate from animals directly into humans. And so, you know, the big data approach, I think, actually is almost better suited to complex diseases in humans. The second piece of it is we've built a medical system and a research system that's been very good at identifying and understanding simple, singular focus, singular cause diseases. Well, Lyme disease may be sort of part of that, in that we have a causative organism, but it's obviously got a complexity to it beyond that, in terms of both what would have already been highlighted today in terms of other tick-borne illnesses, other co-infections, but also immune reactivity and immune response. And so I think that requires a bigger data approach.
For exactly that reason, you can do co-infections in animals, and not, you know, you can ask these questions in animals where you're applying a second infectious agent. You can ask questions about causality rather than, you know, by actually manipulating the animal systems. And I would just like to say about the study that was published 5 years ago, even though it came out of Stanford, there's a lot of you know, there are a lot of arguments that might be one way to look at it, but there are other ways of doing it. So I think that we have benefited from animal models over the last 70, 80 years, and that sort of throwing them out because we can now sequence everything in the human is probably a little bit.
I wasn't suggesting to throw them out. I'm just saying use them judiciously.
So I guess what I would Lyme actually represents a really interesting case. So I don't want to dive into the mouse versus human debate, because that's really, that paper was kind of a firestorm and it's still hotly debated. I think what would be really interesting to do from a big data standpoint is we have so much data on animal models and we have a lot of data on the human model, and actually compare where are they similar and where do they diverge. Actually have some efforts to try to do that, to look at, you know, what can we borrow from both to really further our understanding. You know, Lyme represents a really interesting case because you have this coevolution in rodents, and so just like in the wild, you know, humans are the dead end for Lyme infection in some way. So really understanding, you know, there's been crazy ideas like, can we genetically modify the mice population so that they'll no longer be infected, and so ticks won't matter anymore, and they will not be the vectors of Borrelia. So, I mean, it's. I think we definitely have to consider mice in this equation, because the sort of whole ecology and complexity about ticks to bacteria to whether it's rodents and then ultimately humans, there's a lot of interplay between these organisms. And yeah, I think we could use big data to try to understand those questions.
Secondary pitch for humans, we have 300,000 cases of Lyme disease newly diagnosed in this country every year.
If 10% of those, or even 20% of those, become persistent cases, that's 30,000 to 60,000 people. Those are experiments that are happening in clinics across this country every day that go unmeasured. And those are relatively easy to capture, actually, and that's part of what we've gone in and done with clinicians across the country, where those patients are getting blood drawn and getting treatments every day of the week, you know, and those are easy things to start to measure, to look at the efficacy of what's being done today in the clinic and what should be done and what is the most efficacious or completely non-efficacious. And we are missing a lot of those experiments simply because that data isn't being collected. And omics, I think, opens up a whole other set of tools to look at those kinds of cases.
All right, that seems like a hot question there. So we'll move on to some other. So I guess we got one with the mic right there, and then
yes.
We'll keep going to the other questions.
Dr. Kidd and Schutzer, you were both talking about specific sets of Lyme patients that were very clearly defined. And Dr. Kidd, in your example, you were talking about multiple myeloma, which is very, there's a very definite diagnosis there. With Lyme disease, we don't have a really 100% reliable test to test for active disease. So I, from what I'm seeing, within the next 2 years, we should have that, and maybe a test that will also clearly diagnose the co-infections that patients might have, tick-borne diseases. So it's a very complex issue, and I think your big data and what you're testing as well, Stephen, might have to be readjusted for that. And I just wonder also if you start seeing that things like Borrelia miyamotoi and the other Borrelias maybe be confused with Borrelia burgdorferi, and there are some commonalities there, how would you adjust for those things?
Okay. So as I explained, when we're looking basically diagnostically. That's one of my goals, to get good diagnostic tests for early disease first and then expand out. So we have to start eliminating the heterogeneity at first and go to a more of a homogeneous group. So once we have that tools, we get new tools in place, like a diagnostic test, then we expand out and see how many other people are covering it in. And obviously someone who has erythema migrans, like a clear ring within a ring, well, that's a good case, and you treat anyway, regardless of a test. But that substantiation to regulatory bodies, when you start with that, and then you go and find other molecular evidence that they have Lyme disease, so you prove that it's a true case. Okay, what's an FDA type term? And then you could go, and then you validate your assays. There's multiple ways to validate assays. It's internal validation, there's preliminary validation, and then once you have it, you got a solid tool that the community, research, health community, insurance community, buys into, then you could apply it to other groups. So you can get boost along the way doing this from bioinformatics, and we don't have to do the big data. You know, that's for the rest of the guys, like Joel, to do, you know. So that's where it's very helpful to partner in this case. I don't know if that exactly answers your question, but we have to start somewhere.
So I think having a more definitive diagnosis, you know, or at least molecular, would be fantastic. And, you know, one of the things, and this is even true in cancer, there's a lot of individual variability and in how people progress. And there's a lot of heterogeneity in Lyme in terms of their responses and also how they progress. And being able to tie those molecular, the sort of diagnosis with into finer and finer molecular subgroups would really help, I think, with treatment. So I don't know that it would be a reconfiguration of what we're doing. It would actually allow us to anchor to molecular profiles or immune responses that we could then target the treatments more, hopefully more effectively. So I am really excited by that possibility.
Yeah, there, and then let's get Kim a mic too.
I'm sorry.
Where's the other mic? Oh, we got there. Actually, sorry, there first and then there. I'm sorry, he's been waiting.
I want to ask this forum a question, and it has to do with the clinical setting. You know, we get a patient, set of symptoms, achy, cognitive decline, lives in Lyme endemic area. We send a Western blot, ELISA, we get positive results, and they are positive, and we assume this is Lyme disease, and we start treating that direction. In terms of diagnostics of this setting, is there a possibility to bring to the clinical realm a PCR test that would be a multiple analysis? You know, you don't know what infections, what pathogens are in the sample. Can we take a sample and analyze it and isolate all the pathogens that are there and then continue?
Yes.
Go ahead. Well, the answer is yes, but things are complex and expensive. You know, you can really drill down with high throughput sequencing, but it's not so cheap to go and you just can't do this in a lot of patients yet. As the cost comes down, you can do it, but then you still have to validate to make sure you're not picking up some contaminant. You know, that's happened in some clinical labs, and certainly in a research lab. You want to even make sure the reagents or the kit that you're using is really pathogen or amplicon free. So we have the ability to do it. It's a good way, but we don't want to bite off more than we could chew at the moment. Now, I'm not speaking for everybody, but I'm saying we don't want to muck up the field before we at least show we got some pathways, you know.
You also have to...
What?
We might be chewing on the wrong sandwich.
You also need to think about temporal issues in terms of when the draw was done and what kind of sample it is. Like malaria, if you don't do the draw at the right time, you're going to miss the bug. And we don't know about if there's an optimal timing for Lyme disease.
Plus, as well, there's a number of other tests that are already out there for things like TB, but it also depends on the sample that you're collecting. You know, TB can be done quite readily with the expert from Cepheid, but you need the sputum to do that. And so that has gone a long way in actually getting good specificity these days. But, you know, going to many different populations from pediatric populations through to adults, it's not that easy. So, you know, we really got to be thinking about what types of samples we're collecting as well.
I actually have more of a comment than a question, but when you're thinking about patterns in infectious disease or patterns of disease or biomarkers, there are two factors. There's the host and there's the pathogen. And I think when it comes down to looking at animal models and humans, we have the benefit of the mouse model. We can control the pathogen and we can control the genetic background of the host. I work in the non-human primate model. We have a diverse genetic background, but we can control the pathogen. And then we have the humans, where you have diversity in both the pathogen and the host. And I really think that we all need to find ways to put our data together to find the best answers and to identify biomarkers that are legitimate and reliable.
No, I agree. I mean, having data actually to be shared is one of the biggest steps. And things with the proteomics, I think with Stephen and collaborators that Stephen has at PNNL, has been the only data set for comprehensive proteomics that have been out there so far. But again, it's all raw data. And so what we need to do is move that data into a public forum in which everyone can start to put through. And that's something that we'll be putting forward pretty soon. But, you know, that's really where we need to be at the moment, is how to share that data, how to integrate that data together, rather than just having plonks of data files, raw data file stuff somewhere.
I agree.
My question is probably for Brian Kidd and for the rest of the panel, I suppose. It would be very nice to have a predictive marker for PTLDS. You know, when a patient gets an acute infection, it would be nice to know who are going to go on to develop PTLDS or not. Now, John Alcott and his group have been doing good work in that direction, but one starts wondering whether a single marker is going to be highly predictive, or you need really a data set, a readout on big data that will give you with high fidelity that kind of a prediction that will then, of course, also hopefully translate into the population of people with PTLDS who have had it for a while. Do they still contain that kind of a, if not a marker, but rather a big data signature? Have you guys been thinking about that?
I agree. I think having, you know, we're moving more towards patterns rather than single markers and profiles of a collection of markers. This has been true for who's going to respond to cancer therapies. This has also been true for who's going to respond to, say, flu vaccines. So having a more comprehensive panel of the immune response has been better for predicting, you know, responders, non-responders to various treatments, to actually matching individuals to treatments. So I think in complex diseases in general, that has been the trend, is to move towards not a single biomarker, maybe for a diagnosis, but for like a prediction on, you know, trajectories for individuals. The profiles have been more, they have been better.
I think one of the best examples at the moment has come out of Dan Zak's group at the Center for Infectious Disease Research Institute. So what he's done is look through all of the transcript big data sets for TB infection, and has now come up with a set of markers, human markers, that can predict 18 months in advance of someone going from latent infection to active infection. I think once that's validated and actually becomes a bit of a test, it gives an example of how big data can be used to look at those long-term chronic infections. And with the efforts that Joel's doing here as well, I think, you know, I suppose the field is ripe to actually reap those rewards as well.
So I want to try to fit in. We unfortunately have time for one more question, and we have one question in the back. But I just want to note that right after this, we do have a break. So if you have your burning questions, please feel free to come up and assault the panelists here with those questions afterwards. But we'll take one more question in the back.
Okay. I realize that there's an entire panel on vaccination at the end of the day, but I wanted to ask the question of this panel specifically. Where do you folks see the best opportunity for big data to actually contribute to possible development of a vaccine for Lyme disease?
I don't have an exact answer, but sometimes by collecting data, you can eliminate adverse effects. And so it's complex, but you could still gather information. Sometimes screening stuff for, I'll just give a more concrete example. When some vaccines are not pure, okay, you think they're pure, you know, this is all going back a ways, but there's other things inside it. It could be a virus or a particle or something, and you may be accidentally vaccinating against something you never thought of. Now, with today, that probably should not happen, but if you have the data and a data set and there is an adverse effect, you can actually dip into that fairly rapidly and see, is there, you know, is it an unusual event or is there some statistical backup for it?
I think one area that would be really interesting to try, so usually in vaccine work it's kind of a single measure. You know, you have the titer, you don't, and so the vaccine worked or didn't in promoting, you know, titer. And that often hides a lot of complexity. And so the place where it would be potentially most useful for big data would be to actually measure a bunch of other markers in addition to see if patients are or are not responding or are not mounting various titers, why might that be? And so how you would then potentially modify the vaccine to really bring on board the various aspects of the immune system to get a titer response that would be an effective vaccination response. And I think, you know, we'll definitely talk more about that later. But I think peeling apart the complexity, we've seen a lot in, especially within flu vaccines, having the additional measurements besides just antibody titer actually allows you to segregate why patients mounted antibody titers, if they didn't, why they didn't. And then segregate patients accordingly.
I think it's worth noting that the work that Brian's talking about, I agree, is extremely important, but that's stuff that's relatively new just in the last 5 years and is being applied to flu vaccine, which has obviously a much more mainstream place in medicine. So, you know, the fact that it's even being talked about in Lyme is actually pretty astounding.
I think some of the things that came out of the disastrous trial in South Africa were There was a HIV vaccinology trial there where, in the end, a lot of patients actually were more susceptible to HIV. Subsequent to that trial, the big data analysis had drawn conclusions there. And I think with all of the tools that have been developed there, this is something that Lyme or other diseases like that can also lend off. So I think big data plays a huge role in vaccinology as well.
All right, thanks. And with that, I'd like to give a round of applause to the panelists here. Great.